The world desperately needs Jesus Christ. Every soul on this earth desperately needs the infinite love from the Sacred Heart of Jesus Christ, his salvation, his truth, his forgiveness, his sacramental grace, his eternal life, his kingdom. The apostles were convinced of this. They were convinced that Jesus Christ is the answer. He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the only Savior in the world. They heard the mission that Jesus gave them. Go, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always until the end of the age. And they responded. They didn't say, well, you know, that kind of makes me uncomfortable, Lord. You know, I don't really, what about if I just stay home and pray? I mean, I don't want to offend people. Can't do that. What if they don't like me? I mean, I don't know if I could handle it if they blocked me on Facebook, Jesus. No, they went out. They risked everything, risked their lives, gave their lives. Convinced Jesus is the answer to every human heart on this planet. And the Lord, when he sent them out, promised they wouldn't be alone. He sent the Holy Spirit and Pentecost to fill them with the presence of God, to fill them with grace and courage to announce the good news. And the Lord worked great miracles to confirm the truth of the gospel that day and has done so many times over the last 2,000 years. We heard in the Acts of the Apostles of one of these miracles. Peter goes out to proclaim Jesus Christ, and there's people there who don't speak the same language. Kind of a roadblock, right? But God works a miracle. He removes the roadblock, and Peter is preaching in one language, and people hear him in all sorts of languages. And 3,000 people were converted and baptized that day. I mean, I've never had a homily go that well. I mean, if I can keep you awake, I'm happy. And 3,000 converts that day, the power of the Holy Spirit can do amazing things when Catholics say yes and go out and our lights go out and witness to Jesus Christ. So today I want to talk about this mission that we have at Pentecost. I want to talk about the biblical significance of Pentecost, which I think is so beautiful. And then what are the ways we can live out this mission as they did to be a part of this great work of the salvation of souls, which is so needed today. Now, why do we call it Pentecost? Let's start with some of the basics. Why do we call it Pentecost? Well, it's a very simple answer. The Greek word for 50th is Pentecoste. So Pentecost, 50th. And we are 50 days after the Paschal mysteries of Jesus Christ. Now, this feast is, there are people gathered for the feast. So they're like, wait a second, I thought this was a Christian feast. It is a Christian feast, but it's also a fulfillment of an Old Testament feast. Right? As much as Jesus Christ fulfills the Old Testament, the fulfillment of the Passover is now the Holy Mass and the Holy Eucharist. So too with this. There are many feasts that the Lord called the people of Israel to celebrate, but they were three pilgrim feasts, three big feasts where they were called a journey to Jerusalem to celebrate what was going on. One was Passover, of course, which you know about. The fulfillment is in the Mass. Another one was the Feast of Booths. Another one is the Feast of Weeks. It was 7 weeks after Passover. Of course, 7 times 7 is 49, right? And then the 50th day, Pentecost. And it was to celebrate several things. A couple of things. One was to celebrate the harvest, to celebrate God's providential care. Now, that has a little more significance when you think of the people being freed from slavery in Egypt. What are they doing? They're wandering in the desert. And so when you have a harvest, it means you got a land. Can't have crops if you don't have a land. Can't have crops if you're moving every 3 days. And so it reminds them, no, God was faithful to his promise. He brought you out of slavery in Egypt. He's brought you back to the promised land. You have a home. You have a land. You can grow crops. You can raise a family. You can be a people of God. And so that ties into the other thing that they celebrated, and that Jewish people to this day celebrate. Now they call it the Feast of Shavuot, but it's still Pentecost or the Feast of Weeks. And that's the giving of the law. We know after this, after they were freed from slavery in Egypt, brought through the Red Sea, they went to Mount Sinai. And around this time, they would have received the law. God would have done a miraculous deed in coming down from heaven and speaking to Moses. We hear about this in Exodus 16, this great revelation of the glory of God. It says, on the morning of the third day, there were thunders and lightnings and a thick cloud upon the mountains and a very loud trumpet blast, so that all the people who were in the camp trembled. And you imagine Mount Evans being clothed in smoke and hearing trumpet blasts and thunders. You're like, what's happening here? Then Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they took their stand at the foot of the mountain. And Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. And the smoke of it went up like smoke of a kiln. The whole mountain quaked greatly. And as the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him in thunder. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai to the top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up. We see elements. We see God writing history like people write books, right? What's going on? God comes down in fire. What happens at Pentecost? The New Testament fulfillment. God, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Holy Trinity, comes down in fire. God calls Moses to go up and receive the law. To receive, because he's choosing these people as his people. I will be your people and you will be my God. He's reforming, he's rescued them from the slavery of Egypt, the slavery of that darkness, and forming them to be his people, to live in his new covenant. And what's happening at Pentecost? The Lord, they already heard the good news from Jesus Christ, the fullness of the word of God himself incarnate among them, risen from the dead. And now he's sending the Holy Spirit and sending out the church to bring that covenant to the world. A harvest of souls. Wants us not just focused on farming and crops, but what's more important, the harvest of souls, the salvation of souls, because he wants every person on the earth to be his people. He wants every person on the earth to be a follower, a disciple of Jesus Christ. He wants every person on earth to be a devout Catholic in love with Jesus Christ and alive by his grace of salvation. And that may sound to the modern ear, to the modern world, oh, Father, that's so arrogant. Oh, everybody should be Catholic. Yeah, that's the words of Jesus. Go make disciples of all nations. He didn't say, go to all nations and say, hi, keep doing what you're doing. No, he called every single person. Is Jesus Christ Lord? Yes. Did he start the Catholic Church? Yes. Does he want everyone to be alive through baptism, to be restored through confession, to be fed with his, not just manna, the wilderness like the people of Israel ate, but the new manna, the living bread came down from heaven, Jesus Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity. Yes, he wants everyone to know the power of his Spirit, the power of his grace and kingdom. Amen? Today is a great day where we celebrate that the apostles didn't stay in their cowardice or fear. They didn't just say, I don't really feel like it. We wouldn't be here if they did. They received the power of the Holy Spirit. They trusted in the power of the Holy Spirit, and they went out to the four corners of the earth because they knew the truth of Jesus Christ, and they knew that God loves each soul and wants to save them. And we are called to do the same. The church has had the same mission, and the world is still not converted. The majority of the people on earth are still not followers of Jesus Christ. The majority of the people on the earth still do not know Jesus Christ. 5 out of 7 people on the earth, 5 billion out of 7 billion, still don't know Jesus Christ. And so the church still has a critical, critical mission. We'll have that mission until Jesus returns. Now, one of the people that's been inspiring me lately who really lived out this mission, which the mission we receive at confirmation, right? Confirmation is the sacramental way of participating in the grace of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit that we receive at baptism, all the graces that we receive at baptism is strengthened through the sacrament of confirmation. Sacrament of confirmation is the perfection of baptismal grace. And so I've been inspired recently. The kids at the school have been hearing me talk about her. We didn't wait till her confirmation to go out and announce the good news. St. Rose of Viterbo. St. Rose of Viterbo lived in Viterbo, Italy, which is right near Rome. You can take a train from Rome to Viterbo very easily, just in a couple minutes. And when she lived several hundred years ago, and when she was 3 years old, she raised her aunt from the dead. 3 years old. In the name of Jesus Christ, raised her aunt from the dead. I'm telling me kids with faith can't do something. 3 years old. Now, at 10 years old, she was miraculously cured from a deadly illness through the intercession of the Blessed Mother. And shortly after that, Jesus appeared to her with crowned with thorns and bleeding profusely from the crowning of thorns. And looking at Jesus, she was convicted of great love and she said, "My Lord, who has reduced you to this state?" And Jesus replied, "My love, my deep love for men has done this." But Rose of Viterbo said, "But who has so pierced and torn you?" "The sins of men have done it," was our Lord's answer. "Sin, sin," cried the saint. And she did penance and reparation. But she didn't stop there. She didn't just pray and do penance, as important and as critical as that is. Inspired by the love of God, she knew souls needed Jesus Christ. She was living in a town that had grown cold, a town that was Catholic in name, but not on fire. Kind of, "Well, we go to church. Yeah, we don't need to go to church every Sunday. We don't want to be fanatical about it. We don't need to follow all the teachings," right? There were cafeteria Catholics, which is not Catholic at all. If you only follow some of the gospel, you're not a disciple, right? And that's not how disciples work. Disciples follow all of it, totality, otherwise you're placing yourself above the word of God. I'll decide. So she knew that she needed to do something. And at 10 years old, she grabbed a crucifix and started walking through the streets, announcing Jesus Christ, calling people to faith, calling people to conversion. Can you imagine watching a 10-year-old kid walking down the street of your subdivision or wherever you live and saying, "Jesus Christ is Lord, repent and be converted. Go back to confession, turn to Jesus Christ. He is the Savior." And that's what she did. And God showed up to confirm this great courage of this little girl. One day when she was preaching in the street, she was standing on a rock, and God lifted the rock off the ground into the air as she's talking about Jesus Christ. People see her hovering, levitating above the ground, and they're like, maybe we should listen to what she's saying, and started to repent and started to convert. But the leaders in that town didn't like the fact that, oh, the people were following Jesus instead of them, and they're, you know, living in disobedience and their control. And so they kicked her out of the town. They exiled her and her family. But she didn't get discouraged. She didn't give up. She'd say, "Well, you know, we tried. All right, what's on TV?" No. She went to other towns to announce Jesus Christ. So we're not done. One town she went to was this sorceress that was caught up in witchcraft, caught up in all sorts of occult stuff, and was really leading people astray. And so she went to this town square to tell people about Jesus Christ, but wasn't having much success because they were so confused by this sorceress. And so she prayed and felt inspired, and she went and stood in the middle of a bonfire, in the middle of a fire for 3 hours, praising God and proclaiming Jesus Christ. Stood in the middle of a huge fire for 3 hours. Now, everybody in the town saw this, and if they weren't there when it happened, they had 3 hours to get there. And the whole town converted. The sorceress herself saw this and repented of her wickedness and converted to Jesus Christ. And all of this before she died at 18. You telling me a kid can't change lives? You telling me a kid's got to be about kicking a ball and playing a game and, "Oh, we can't do that. We can't be involved in that." She did all that before she died at 18. The Lord can work great miracles through anybody who's willing to say, "Yes, here I am, Lord. I want to announce the good news." So what are some practical ways that we can embrace this mission, embrace the grace of confirmation, embrace the Holy Spirit, and go out? Just so critical. And I think it's important that we recognize that Jesus is the answer. You know, we see all the stuff going on with all the violence in the news, all everything. And when I hear, you know, you listen to it, you hear things that, you know, you don't hear the most important thing. I hear, "Oh, we need to focus on laws," or "We need to focus on mental health issues." And all those things are real. Laws are important. Laws educate. Laws guide. There's lots of mental health issues. There's much need for counseling and all of that. Those are all important. But what I don't hear oftentimes is the most important, because you can have zero mental health issues and you can have perfect laws and still sin and still do evil, right? The crisis isn't first and foremost a crisis of laws and a need for more counseling, as important as those are. It's a crisis. It's the same crisis it's always been, a crisis of sin and death, a need for Jesus Christ, a need for salvation, a need for grace. Because you can have all the laws in the world, but if you don't have the love of Jesus Christ, you're missing the very meaning, the very purpose How is someone going to find true life and true purpose except through Jesus Christ? What's going on in the world is a spiritual crisis, a loss of faith, a loss of actual infinite love dwelling in people's souls, giving them life, giving them joy, giving the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And so when we see that, when we believe that, what is every person on the earth looking for? They're looking for infinite love. And if you say they're looking for something less, that's denigrating. That's looking at them, no, they just need more money and better economic plans. No, they need the infinite love of Jesus Christ. So that's the first thing, to be convicted that he is the answer to every human heart. There may be other things that need to happen as well, but if that's not there, they're missing the very foundation of the house and you're just building a sandcastle. And so what are practical ways? One is to be visible about our faith in word and actions. There's so many ways we can be visible. Maybe you've heard that line, if you were arrested for being Catholic, would they have enough evidence to convict you? Right? Do people at work know you're Catholic? Is there a crucifix, or is there an image of the Sacred Heart or the Blessed Mother at your desk where it might inspire a conversation? Hey, I didn't know you were Catholic. Yeah, I'm happy to talk about it anytime you want. Ever want to come to church with us? Is there Catholic art in your home so when you invite your friends, whether they're Catholic or non-Catholics, you invite your relatives, we're all over the map. Maybe there's some beautiful art that inspires them to say, hey, what's that about? Oh, let me tell you, to spark a conversation. Something as simple as posting in social media about Jesus Christ, an inspiring homily, inspiring video, articles in the faith. There's so many good resources, right? The world doesn't need more pictures of your lunch. The world needs more Jesus Christ. Sorry to break it to you. How dare you, Father? I'm so offended. Get over it. And to get involved in charity. Of course, with our financial donations, that's important, but with our time as well, with our presence, with our heart, to minister, to witness to the poor, to go out and get involved in pouring out love in the poor and caring for souls. There's so many ways that we can be visible in words and actions where people will see our good deeds and give glory to the Father. And then secondly, to make the invitation. All the charity in the world is important, but we got to make the invitation. You never know what the Lord can do with an invitation. I've mentioned this before and I'll keep mentioning it. To invite a friend at Mass, to invite a non-Catholic and to sit with them and explain what we do here and why. To invite them to a talk that we have at the parish or praise and worship that we have once a month, to a Bible study, to invite them to consider becoming Catholic. Ask the question of your neighbors, of your friends, or your family members. Have you ever thought about becoming Catholic? Oh, Father, you don't know what the Holy Spirit's been working in their lives. You don't know what the Holy Spirit can do. I can tell you story after story of people who risked it and God showed up and they converted. You never know what the Holy Spirit can do with an invitation. But we do know what he does with silence and with no invitation. Of course, nothing. There's nothing there. To be very clear about handing on our faith to our kids and our family members and to not... to not use it as an excuse. Well, Father, I'll just keep inviting my kids. I don't, when they come back, maybe then I'll think about going and inviting others. That's such a, I understand wanting your kids to come back, but it's an excuse to say, well, I'm just going to focus on them. I don't have to focus on other people. Listen, maybe they're not going to listen to you, but maybe they will listen to another Catholic who was out evangelizing. But if we use it as an excuse to say, well, I can't do that because I just got to focus on me and my family and my kids. The world keeps falling apart. We never know what the Holy Spirit can do. To be diligent about announcing the good news to anyone who's willing to listen. I've mentioned this before. Parents have to be so diligent today of really handing on the faith. It's not enough to bring them to Mass, as critical and vital and necessary, as important as that is, or just drop them off at RE, as important as it is to bring them to RE. The world's got too much noise throwing at them. They need more of the good news, so that Jesus Christ doesn't get drowned out by the garbage of social media. My brothers and sisters, God is still passionately in love with every soul on earth. He wants them to know his saving grace. He wants them to know the indwelling presence of his most blessed self, the most blessed Trinity. He wants them to experience his presence in the Eucharist, his mercy and confession. He wants them to experience being of one family, one faith, one body in Jesus Christ. So will we respond? What can we do this week, this month, this summer? What can we do to change lives? Such a beautiful gift. It's not a guilt trip. If you're hearing this as a guilt trip, you're totally messing with my point. This is a great gift. God could have said, you know what? This isn't too important. I'm not going to let you be a part of it. You go work in a factory. You produce your parts. I'll do the work of evangelization. How tragic would that be? How sad of a life that would be. Well, he gets to do the important stuff. We don't really get to be a part of it. I mean, every computer program I ever wrote as a programmer is gone. It's not being used. Every part people make in a factory, everything they produce in a few decades will cease to exist. None of it has any eternal significance. Souls last forever. And what an amazing gift that the Lord risks it. He says, you know what? I'm going to call you to share in something even greater than any earthly thing. And us just building houses. I'm gonna invite you to share in the work of the salvation of souls, something that has eternal, enduring significance. And today's the day to say yes. Here I am, Lord. As broken and as weak as I am, I place not my trust in my own abilities, but I do trust in your Holy Spirit. And to go out into the whole world and to announce that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son so that those who believe in him might not perish, but have eternal life.